sticking around. If this is going to be a great talk. I have the pleasure of introducing our speaker today is Matt Ward. Matt is the founder of Breakthrough Champion. In 2002, Matt began working with businesses through his website agency, In Concert Web Solutions, to improve their bottom line, gain more clients, and grow their respective businesses. He sold that agency in 2018 and now is traveling the country as a full-time speaker. He's the author of Making Your Website Effective, and his newest book that was released in September 2018, More Word-of-Mouth Referrals, Lifelong Customers, and Raving Fans. Today, Matt is going to share with us some principles contained in his new book so that you can up-level your referral game. Since 2002, Matt has spoken at hundreds of business events, seminars, conferences, and associations, including SCORE, the Better Business Bureau, and the Vacation Rental Success Summit in Toronto, Canada. Matt and his companies has received numerous awards, including 40 Under 40, Chamber Small Business Owner of the Year, Top Web Firm 7 years in a row, and Better Business Bureau Torch Award finalist. Matt has always believed that businesses are driven by word-of-mouth referrals. Today, we are pleased to provide you with this session, How to Get More Word-of-Mouth Referrals by Exceeding Your Guest Expectations. Please join me in welcoming professional speaker and vacation rental owner, Matt Ward.
Well, thank you for coming to the Northwest Vacation Rental Professionals Conference right here in Sun River. Nice job on you. Give yourself a round of applause. As you heard, my name is Matthew Ward, not Matthew McConaughey. I'm hoping to share with you some principles that I wrote in my book, How to Get More Word-of-Mouth Referrals. Does this sound like a good idea? Yes or yes? All right. This photo right here is a photo of me, shocker. It's photoshopped. This one is not. That is dapper, Matt Ward. 1991 high school prom in Hershey, Pennsylvania. That's right. I grew up in Chocolate Town, USA. How many of you have ever been there? Yes? So you know I'm not lying when I tell you there are two awesome things about Hershey. The first of which is the streetlights are wrapped and unwrapped Hershey kisses. Pretty cool. The second of which is yeah, it smells like chocolate. Do that with me real quick. Ready? Go. You smell that? No. You see, I can smell that because I spent 7 years of my childhood growing up at the Milton Hershey School in Hershey, Pennsylvania. So when you buy chocolate from Hershey Foods, you help disadvantaged kids, kids that didn't have a shot at life. Spent 7 years there. I smelled that chocolate every day. Whenever I close my eyes and take that deep breath, I get that feeling, that smell of chocolate. And when you grow up in Hershey, one big problem. How do you think I got this big? I mean, heck, I gained a pound every day just breathing. Hershey's an iconic brand. How can you guys build an iconic brand for your vacation rental management companies? That's the challenge that we're faced in this day and age, to figure out how we can stand out and get those direct bookings on a more consistent basis. So let me introduce you to John. John is in the sock business. John's Crazy Socks. John founded John's Crazy Socks just 2 short years ago with his dad, Mark, and he loves socks. That's John and his dad, Mark Cronin. And they absolutely love going into business together and finding ways to impress our customers. You see, when you buy socks from johnscrazysocks.com, including your Tom Brady socks, you don't just get socks, but you also get candy and a handwritten note from John himself. And if you're fortunate enough to live on Long Island, you might just be lucky enough to meet John in person when he hand delivers the socks to your door. You see, John's mission is to spread happiness. And aren't crazy socks just so much fun? We got some friends from Hawaii in here. You guys could be giving crazy socks to all your guests. How many people have their crazy socks on today? Yeah, me, I got my struggle bus socks on. Right, Diane? See, crazy socks tell a story, both to yourself and to others. What are your hobbies? What do you like to do? And what's important to you? What are you thinking right at the moment? Like, maybe I'll get this figured out someday. What if your mission was to spread happiness? How would you feel? Pretty deep thought, huh? But more importantly, how would you make others feel? You see, that's the key with spreading happiness. I feel like somewhere along the way, sales got a little lost, right? We kind of went from caring in this mode to a little something different. And I see some heads nodding already because we despise these sales pitches. We can't stand going to the car dealership. At some point in our lives, I feel like sales, it's just messed up. We shouldn't be having sales pitches. We should be having conversations. So I feel like we need to hit the reset button. Because John's company isn't the only one that's figured out how to create a lot of word-of-mouth referrals. Many companies do this. Many of you already do this. I've seen it myself the last 3 days. I've also heard stories about how your businesses got started. Some of you had a second home, and you thought, maybe I should turn that into a business. And then all of a sudden, you had 200 properties you're managing. Good on you. See, I define those stories as accidental business owners. We didn't really intend to do it. We found ourselves doing it. That's kind of what I was. I was coaching football, youth football. This is a Mighty Mike coach. That's the 6 and 7 year olds just teaching them how to play football. And a parent walked up on the field one day and said to me, Matt, you should start a web design company. And I looked at her and said, Erica, what do I know about that? She said, well, you built our website. I said, you think I built your website? In reality, I was working at a software company, and somebody who knew how to build websites said, it's a nonprofit, I'll do it for free. I basically outsourced the website building that I volunteered to do. That was the aha moment for me. So I go into business, and I'm thinking, I'm a rock star. You know, I'm the head football coach of the 6 and 7 year old tiny mites. I felt like I was this guy. Come on, another Super Bowl, 18 in a row. When in reality, I'm like many other small business owners out in this world just trying to figure it out, I'm like this guy. Every day, I'm putting one foot in front of the other just trying to figure this whole thing out. And I know that's what you're up to, too. Because I've been in your shoes. And I am a vacation rental owner. I know the struggles. I don't know what it's like to manage 200 properties. But if it's anything like managing one, I'm up to here already. What I did know in business was that I didn't like sales. That I knew. So how do I fix that? How do I get people to call me? I beg people? That's a little unbecoming. I had to figure out how to get more word-of-mouth referrals. So over the 16 years I owned my website company, which I just sold last year to an employee, the first 12 I did marketing and advertising and all those other things. And the last four, not a single new client came other than by referral. If you put in process some of these strategies I'm going to share with you today, over time, you will build a referral engine like no other. Sometimes you have to balance that with marketing and advertising. And so we want to make sure that we're consistently moving forward our efforts on the referral side so that we can slowly take it over. So I'm going to share with you today the four pillars of what I wrote about in my book and some stories associated around those. The first of which is over-delivery. Now, I define this as exceeding your client's expectations. How do we do that? We got to know what their expectations are. How do we do that? We talk to them. It's not hard, but we have to talk to them. In the day and age of internet and email, we have to talk to these people because they tell us so much. Some of the stories I've heard this week at this conference are about conversations people had that turned into amazing experiences later. You see, Maya Angelou has been quoted as saying that people won't remember what you said, and they won't remember what you did, but they will remember how you made them feel. Conversations start that process. This is my friend Majid. He hails from Toronto, Canada. Anybody else here from Toronto, Canada? Two? All right. So Majid is a consultant. He runs small little retreats in Toronto. You fly into Toronto, you hire Majid, and he works with you for 2.5 days over a weekend. And part of the process is he says, I'll pick you up at the hotel. So what's he do? Sends a car, right? Sends your typical Uber, right? No, he sends a limo. How many of you are picking up your guests in limousines? Now you might say, well, I don't know. I don't know if that fits in the model. I don't know if that fits in the budget. But something similar does. Majid just did it one better than what everybody else is doing who is comping for an Uber ride or comping for transportation or arranging a ride. Majid reports to me that not a single person has refused to get into that car. Isn't that the type of customer experience you would love to have with your guests? And how about your property owners when you're meeting them for coffee? What would that be like, right? Anybody here familiar with the Big Ten Network, the Big Ten Network? Yeah. So I had no idea what this was. I mean, I knew it was a sports network, but as a vacation rental owner, one of the early inquiries I got was from Jed in Michigan. Jed was renting my property in Fort Myers, Florida in March. And Jed is a huge basketball fan. I'm talking huge. Like literally, if a basketball game's on, they're not even celebrating holidays. He postponed his daughter's wedding because Michigan was playing in the tournament. So Jed booked in March, which happens in March to be March Madness. So he contacts me and says, hey, by the way, do you have the Big Ten Network? And I'm like, what's that? Like, okay, I assume that's a cable channel. Let me call, let me find out, let me do some Googling. So I call Comcast and no, I don't have it. Well, is it available? Yeah, it's available. So what are my options? I'm thinking through my options, I'm thinking, how about if I just add the channel? And then I tell them, oh, by the way, it's 10 bucks for the month, just PayPal me 10 bucks. Or maybe I say, Jet, you know, it's $10, give me the $10. Oh, by the way, there's a bar down the street called Gator Bites, and a lot of sports people, it's a sports bar. If Michigan wins, go celebrate with them. They're all Michigan people, and you'll have a great time. Or I could waive the $10, because it's $10, right? It's $10. And so I called Jet, and I said, Jet, I didn't have the Big Ten Network, but I got it. I got it for you. It's 10 bucks, no charge. So you hear him perk up a little bit. Ooh. I said, by the way, there's Gator Bites right down the street, less than a mile away. A lot of sports fans will watch the games down there, and if Michigan wins, you can go celebrate with them. Yeah, imagine turning over a gator. That'd be fun. I said, but so enjoy the game. And I hung up the phone and I thought to myself, well, that was nice. It was $10 and some information. But I can do better than that. So I called up a friend in Massachusetts who does wood burning and the cutting boards. And I had her create a custom cutting board for Jed with a basketball court, the three-point arcs, the foul lines, and prominently displayed in the middle, the University of Michigan logo, the big M. I packed it up and I shipped it to Jed. And what do you think Jed did? He opened it up, he text messaged, he called and left a voicemail, I'm so thankful, and then he went to Facebook. These people are awesome. That's what the cutting board looked like. $20. It's not the best cutting board in the world, but Jed doesn't care. Jed doesn't even care if he can eat off of that. He probably took it home and put a nail in the back of it. So what did I do? I called Marie, and I ordered another one so I could show you guys exactly what I did. $20, and this guy's talking about us. That's how you get referrals. You find a way to ask yourself one simple question. How can I do this one better? One better. Because as we well know in this room, there's a lot of managers out there, a lot of owners out there, and they're going through the motions. They're doing things that are just, you know, good enough. Good enough isn't good enough, folks. We gotta level it up. As a property manager or an owner, when you walk into your home and have a painting crew there, and it's a three-day job to paint your living room, and you see this on the wall, what on earth are they thinking? The first thing that crosses your mind is, wait a second, I had to tell you to take the cover plates off? The second thing is, even if you didn't take them off, you can't even tape around that correctly. Because people think that good enough is good enough. And if you have a friend who's a painting contractor, what you need to tell him is, to over-deliver to a customer, they need to take all the cover plates off. Duh, that's the first thing we do. The second thing is we find all the cracked and stained ones and we replace them. Then we bring the stack to the owner and say, Jane Doe, client, I replaced all these plates. Here they are, keep them in the stash in case another one breaks. Maybe this one will be better at that time. But really what you're doing is you're showing them that you over-delivered because they can't always see that. And then you follow that up with, oh, by the way, no charge. See, the problem with painters is they don't do this because it costs 30 cents a plate and they gotta replace a dozen of them. What's that, $3-4? They're worried so much about the money that they fail to see all the referral money that could be coming if they just did that as a standard operating procedure. That's what we need to make sure we eliminate. That good enough is not at all good enough. So that's pillar number one, is over delivery, exceeding client expectations. Pillar number two, listening. Now, a lot of people in this world talk about listening. I define this as speak less and care more. Speak less and care more. In my book, I talk about listening with your eyes and your ears. With a show of hands in here, how many of you connect on Facebook with your owners, their property owners as managers? Yes? Your friends on Facebook? Very few. Facebook is the number one resource for you to learn about information about them and their family. Stuff is posted there all the time that they would never say to you in person. Trials and tribulations, family deaths. They don't announce these via email broadcast messages or text messages to you. They announce them on Facebook and on Instagram. So whatever social media channel you're on, I highly recommend you connect. I call that social media espionage. All you're doing is you're learning stuff about other people that you can use in a positive way in the future. This is Ronnie Bartles. Ronnie Bartles was a partner of mine at the In Concert company. Now, she had her own company in Charleston, South Carolina. What I mean by partner is we referred each other. We were referral partners. And I used to read her blogs because she's a great writer, an absolutely great writer. And her blogs were funny. And she wrote a blog about how sweet and salty can sometimes work. And buried in that, you know, 1,000-word blog was a single sentence for her professing her love for chocolate-covered bacon. So what I do? Chocolate-covered bacon sourced and delivered to her house. And what does Ronnie Bartles do as a marketer? I only knew it got delivered not by the tracking number, but because all my notifications on social media were going off. That's what people do when you care about them. They tell the world. People that you don't even know exist because they have roughly 250 contacts that they're telling about you. I mentioned briefly that I'm a fortunate graduate of the Milton Hershey School in Hershey, Pennsylvania. This is in the high school I went to. It's on the hill across from Hershey Park. If you've ever been there, you look up, it looks like a castle. And it's a private tuition-free boarding school. And so I'm very honored to be living a life that I've dreamed of living. And primarily because this school taught me hard work, dedication, and grit to figure out things on my own. I don't have a college degree. I'm the youngest of three boys, the first to graduate high school, and the only one not to go to prison. This school changed my life. And every day I wear my high school class ring on my ring finger to remind me about that school. People know who are connected with me on Facebook that I share stuff about Hershey all the time. And so I worked with a consultant one time regarding my speaking career. Her name is Tamsin Webster. She ran for 15 years one of the most popular TEDx organizations, TEDx Cambridge in Boston, Massachusetts. She's a doll. I did a workshop with her, but I referred another speaker to the same workshop. And so what did Tamsin do? Yeah, she thanked me. Not by email, but by a handwritten card. Ding, point number one. Handwritten cards, super valuable. But interestingly enough, inside that card were 9 postcards about Hershey. You wanna make my heart melt? That's a dog. You wanna make my heart melt? Send me postcards about Hershey. Send me anything about Hershey. Because it's connected deep in my soul. I'm what they call a one percenter. I'm a 1% for that brand. 1% of people that truly believe in that brand no matter what happens. And I'm a 1%er for the school. The fact that she knew that and included that in a handwritten card, I'd refer a lot of people. And now look, standing on a stage across the country talking about her. People will do that for you too. This is Jack. Jack was the dog of a longtime client, a client who was a landscaper. And so Jack would ride in the truck with Matt Landry. And one day, Matt's wife posted on Facebook that Jack had passed away. Now, those of you who own dogs know the tough nature of that. But when a dog is at your side in your work truck every single day, it's an even greater loss. I saw that and I said, gotta send him a card. And then I said, I gotta do it one better. So I bought him a memorial stone with Jack's name on it. Now looking at that stone, you might think that was thousands of dollars. You might even think that was 200 bucks, but I'm gonna tell you right now, online that was $20. Are we finding ways to connect with people that matter so much to them? Are we listening? Are we speaking less and caring more? That's the key behind the second pillar. The third pillar is surprise. I define this as an unexpected gift at an unexpected time. So some of you might know that I run a podcast for over 2 years called the Square Peg Round Hole Small Business Podcast. It's currently on hiatus. Don't listen to my podcast. Listen to Heather Bayer's podcast. It's better. But I interviewed a guy by the name of Scott McKenzie. Scott McKenzie runs the Industrial Talk podcast. And after every guest came on my podcast, I mailed them a handwritten card. And about 6 months later, Scott and I had kind of hit it off. We're one of those people who just, we got each other, you know? We vibed. And so I'm following up with Scott, and I'm on a Zoom call just checking in. Scott says, hold on 1 minute. 6 months after I mailed him the card, hold on 1 minute, gotta show you something. Comes right back on screen, and boop, there's the card. People keep your handwritten cards. They put them in shoeboxes. I do that. Scott and I still talk about this card. He cannot believe I mailed him a card. Folks, you gotta go from the inbox to the mailbox, because nothing's getting through the inbox anymore. There's a lot of noise out there. Find a way to cut through. Let's go to the inbox, the mailbox. Go to the mailbox. Find ways to get in that mailbox, because that is going to produce memorable experiences that you make them feel great, and they're gonna produce referrals. When you do it, be intentional when you surprise people. Know what you're going to give them. Find ways to do it. On the podcast, I was lucky enough, there's the be intentional slide, I was lucky enough to interview Shannon the Cannon Hudson. Shannon Hudson was episode 4. Shannon was the founder of 9Round, a fitness franchise. Now, if you want a good laugh, go download this episode, because in the first 15 minutes, Shannon must have mentioned the word fitness about 50 times. Well, I got a fitness business and we're growing the fitness business. Finally, I had to cut him off and say, listen, I'm not sure if you realize, you can't see me because we're on a podcast. I'm a pretty big dude. Like, fitness is not really in my, well, it's in my vocabulary, but in one way. I fit this whole pizza in my mouth. So, 6 weeks later, podcast comes out. What do? I call, I think it was Greenville, South Carolina, Domino's Pizza, and I asked them to write a message on the box and deliver it. Thanks for coming on the podcast. I hope you fit this whole pizza in your mouth. Have you ever had a pizza delivered to somebody else and Domino's goes, you want to do what? Be intentional. Find ways to care about others. Like the folks at this conference did for me. So I'm out walking the other day. This is my new thing. I don't know why I'm doing it. Doesn't go with this motto. Have a no excuses 30-minute walk. I don't care how fast or how slow I go. I don't care if I crawl. It's just gonna be 30 minutes. It's movement. Better than being on an airplane where I can't move, right? So I'm out walking, I come back to my room, and there's a guy getting ready to enter my room. I'm like, what's going on? And he turns, and he's got something in his hands. And he says, is this you? And he holds up a card, and it's got my name on it. I go, yeah, that's me. And inside was a crate with a Boston Strong Yankee candle, because I'm from Boston, 2 ciders, because I drink cider beer, an 18-pound bag of beef jerky. That thing is huge. I know what I'm eating for dinner tonight. And a jar of Hershey Kisses, along with a few other small things. And what do you think I did? I went Facebook Live, recorded on my profile, shared it out to everybody. I was shocked that they had orchestrated that. Because people don't always do that for me. Do people always do that for you? Because when somebody does, that's when you feel it. Take that feeling that people provide to you and start turning it around to others, because that produces referrals. The third pillar is surprise, unexpected gift at an unexpected time. The fourth pillar is non-self-serving acts, doing for others that have no value or benefit to you. So, clearly some of you saw me at the conference. I'm a big Patriots fan. Shocker there, live in Boston, have since 1997. From time to time, my friend Derek Eaton and I have a little banter online about Seahawks or Patriots or whatever it might be. But as I told you, I coached football. I also coached semi-pro football at one point in time. I coached for over 11 years. Loved the game. I played high school football in Hershey. So on my bucket list was the Super Bowl. And I went 2 years ago. Yeah, we lost. We won't talk about that. It's only one. It's only one. But while I was there, a number of my friends were texting me, Facebook messaging me, and saying, don't skimp on the photos. Now, I was lucky enough to be in row 6, sitting with the Patriots staff, and it was actually row 3 because the tunnel was underneath us, so there were only 3 rows. I was right there where they came out, right at the end zone where Gronk missed the catch. And Philly took home the win. As I'm walking out of the place, I'm thinking, wow, I got a ton of people that care about me and that are happy that I could check off a bucket list item, win or lose. So I stopped by a cart, a gift cart, and I bought a number of pins. And everybody that texted me or messaged me during the game or that weekend at all got a pin with a card in the mail. No benefit to me. But I'm showing up in their life just like they showed up in my life. You see, that's how relationships work. Relationships are the key driver behind referrals. And you have to build them over time. They take a long time to generate. We don't get referrals tomorrow when we start in business today. It's a struggle. We still have to do marketing and advertising. But what changed the game for me was this book by Keith Ferrazzi, Never Eat Alone. Clearly you can tell. No. It's not about eating. There's a part in it about that. It's about sharing time with others over meals because you have to eat anyway. But what I really got out of it was to give without the expectation of getting anything in return. Anything in return. So as you start to do this, I'm going to warn you that you will have that thought, but when's my turn? That's okay. That's okay. I read that book in 2007, maybe. That's the Crystal River Reservoir right next to my office at the web design company that I had. As I sat on the bench and read that book, I found it was very enlightening, and I started to change. But about every week, I would think, when's my turn? Then it became every month, every 3 months, every 6 months. And now, I don't know, a couple times a year. But when you hear that thought in your head, you can just recognize it and set it aside. You know that it's okay to hear that. It's just not okay to act on it. And it's like a muscle. It will go away over time. Could take you 2 or 3, 4 years, depending on how good you are at it. The goal of trying to get more referrals is really all about deepening your relationships. Finding ways to provide value to others that matters to them. So that's pillar number 4, non-self-serving acts of no benefit or value to you. The reason we do these things and we combine them into what I call your care package. Care package that you would send to somebody in college or in the military overseas. You don't pack a care package with stuff that you like. You pack it with stuff that they like because you're caring for them. So, when you work on these pillars, sometimes they're alone, sometimes they're together, sometimes it's 2 out of the 4, sometimes it's all 4. It's not about understanding how to put them together, it's just about understanding how to put them in practice. That's the real key. Because after all, referrals come because you're top of mind, right? And isn't that what every marketer in this entire world will tell you? That you spend advertising dollars or marketing dollars so that you can be top of mind. The company that people select at the point in which they're ready to do business. That's why you have a Facebook ad, that's why you do a billboard, that's why you do a magazine ad, that's why you do a tourism brochure, a rack card, because when I'm walking into the thing and I see a rack, right? That's why you do all of those paid advertising things, is to be top of mind. And in the world of marketing, we call it TOMA. That's the acronym, Top of Mind Awareness. The problem is if we do it the wrong way, yeah, we're this guy. How many people bought a car and you go to walk off the lot? Oh, do you have three names of people that you can refer to buy a car to me? And the one thing you're concerned about is when you drive off, it's going to be a lemon. You haven't even driven the car 100 miles and they want a referral. What would the automotive industry look like if you got a card every month for the life of your vehicle? What would the real estate industry be like? What would your owners feel like if they got a card from their manager every month? Or every 3 months? Or even once a year? I don't care what process you put in place, but put something in place that makes it work in a systematic way for you. I always recommend to people we not start off too big. So if you have 180 owners that you're managing clients for, let's not start with 180. You're gonna be overwhelmed. Instead, let's just start with 4 or 5. Get them into a process, see how it works, see how it flows internally, find a way to do that. Makes a lot of sense to do it that way. Would you guys all agree that we could care more? Yes or yes? Awesome. I'm gonna ask you to do a little exercise. I'm gonna ask you to pull out your smartphone devices. And you're gonna go to a website. The website is icancaremore.com. Now, let me be clear about this website. You cannot Google this. You must type it into your browser, Safari browser, Chrome browser, whatever it is. You're going to take a self-assessment as to how well you care about other people. And then we're gonna put the real data of the group on the screen in real time. Are you ready for that? No, actually, we're not gonna do that. What you're gonna do is you're gonna fill out this 15 question, self-assessment, and it is timed to be delivered to you 1 hour later from the time you fill it out. That way you're not sitting there checking your phone looking for your caring score while we wrap up the talk. It should take you about 3 minutes, and if you have a question on how to get to this website right now, you can raise your hand. I don't see any teenagers in the room that could help you, but I'm happy to help as well. And then we're gonna go into a few questions. So just take that, and if anybody's having trouble getting to the website, you should see the survey. Just raise your hand and somebody will help you, myself or somebody else. Oh, what's it? Yes. So the word contacts is used in this survey. I define contacts as the people that are in your life, whether they're personal, business. You'll notice that there's not a single word in there called clients or customers. And I need to tell you why that is. All those referrals I talked about that came in my website company came from people that never did a single piece of business with me. They referred me business because they trusted me and I built relationships with them over a long time, and they have the ability to refer business on a regular basis. They were IT companies. So sometimes people that send you business may never actually rent in the homes or be guests in the homes that they're sending you business for. They might not actually be owners who are customers of yours. And so that's why I call them contacts. Hopefully that makes sense. While you're taking the survey, if some other people who are not taking it have a question, I'm happy to entertain those. And we have a microphone for a number of people Hold on 1 second.
Go ahead. I'm not taking the quiz right now because my cell phone is dead.
Oh.
Sorry, I'll do it later.
Oh, that's okay. Yeah. Did you have a question? Oh. Yeah, you can take it. Yeah, we have a question back here. Hold on for the microphone, and I will gladly take a volunteer to run the mic.
Sorry, I was actually just taking some notes, and I wanted you to go back to the first pillar.
The first pillar?
Yeah.
Is over-delivery.
Okay.
Over-delivery.
I got two, I got three.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so once you're done with the survey, You can just get up and we'll have a dance party. No, we're not going to do that. She's ready to get up and have a dance party. We're going to have some questions here. I'm certain of it. So one of the questions I get all the time, so I'm going to ask it because I know somebody's thinking it. If I want referrals, can't I just ask for them? The answer is no. Because here's what happens when you ask for referrals. You get one of two answers. The first of which is, oh yeah, 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 I got a referral for you. I got somebody that can be that's an owner that might want to put their property. Yeah. His name's Derek Eaton. Derek's not ready, willing, and able to buy. That's a referral, somebody ready, willing, and able to buy. Oftentimes what you get is a lead at best. A lead at best. Somebody that bought a house that was thinking maybe they wanted to do vacation rental management or vacation rental. And so they could place it with your company. The second thing that happens is this really awkward situation where the person's like, oh yeah, yeah, I'll get back to you. And then they never do. It sounds like silence, crickets, birds chirping. You never hear back from them, right? So it's because you're putting them in an awkward situation. So let's stay away from the question of, hey, do you have a referral for me? Do you know somebody that can do this? And instead, let's have other inquisitive questions that we ask about them. Take more care in them, and that'll flip it back around. Any other questions? Wow, you guys are like, great. No questions, what time is it? Okay, cool. Yes, there's a microphone right behind you. I just want to make sure that everybody could hear the question. We could just run it up to her. Yeah? No, it's just fine, you're fine. It's just us, we're just having a conversation.
I think that in our business, because we deal with so many contractors and electricians and plumbers, and I feel like our referrals to those kind of things are sometimes taken advantage of. Mm. People call and pick our brain and it's nice, we like these people, we wanna give them business, but we also like, it's our industry, we're good at doing it. So giving it away for free is kind of a challenge.
So giving what away for free?
The referrals to good people. You know, like we know all this because we've been doing it for so long, and then random people are calling us and saying, you know, who can do this? Who can do this? Who can do this?
Oh, you're like, being asked for a contractor, referral to do plumbing work, for example?
Yeah, and we give lovely people that are obviously doing a good job, but, you know, that's our experience and it's how we make
it's a very common
business.
Problem, right? People want to hoard their contacts. They want to protect them because they do so well for them.
And it's our job to know that, and giving away our job for free is not fun.
Getting away the job for free?
Yeah, giving away our work and our experience to people that just call up in randomly.
Oh, because you vetted them, you mean?
Yeah, I vetted them and worked with them and know they did a good job. And I did do that for people that pay me. So doing it for people that...
So, I mean, I think that... So I would argue that the more robust those trade contractors are, the more likely they are to be around when there's an economic crash. They will beat out everybody else. So if you are, in fact, referring them to other property owners, people that need help, people on Facebook who are looking for a good plumber, then they're going to make more money, their business is going to grow, and they will be there when you need them the most. They also will cater to you because you give them so much business. But we need to have a sort of globalist mentality about referrals, because people refer you when you refer people. So if we're holding on to those referrals to protect them and us, our businesses, what often happens is they don't refer as much. They might be referring, but they will refer a lot more if you're giving of those referrals, because they're going to think about you all the time. And there are situations where you could be giving them 20 and they're not giving you any. That's okay, because the one they do give you, that's going to be the jackpot. And that's why it takes so long on these relationships. The good news is, and I would argue, you're in a position of power because people see you as somebody they respect. You are a connector. They're coming to you. That's what happened to me. I knew so many people through networking. People would just call me up. Who do you know, Matt? Who do you know? And I became the guy that people would call and actually ask, hey, do you know somebody that does websites? I'm like, my company does websites. But I never talked about it. And yet I built a bigger business that way and ultimately was able to refer more people. And then I could pick and choose my clients like I wanted. I didn't have to take every client that came in the door. So I would argue that the more you give, the more you'll get. And there will be more contractors. You know, there would definitely be more of those guys and gals, for sure. Question over here. Can we run the mic over or pass it over? Where? It's on this row at the end here. Matt, can you pass that over? Or Eric?
I'm with Bennington Properties here in Sun River. We have 200 homes, and with the vendor on our website, we have a preferred vendor. And with our homeowners and local area, not only are our vendors appreciative in a way that they're Johnny on the spot when we have something, but we know that when our owners are calling them to do outside work, we're getting work that we prefer. And so our maintenance team isn't having to go back and fix things or get history. And if our homeowners, which many of them are very hard to get a hold of, if the vendors have issues, they already have a relationship with us, and so they're able to contact us and our maintenance team, and we can add into the house notes. So it's really a good network of the teams that we in this industry have.
Yeah, I would agree, and I do think it takes time to get comfortable with it. It doesn't happen overnight, for sure. I mean, referring out another web company, at the time I owned a web company, was really tough. And actually, I just had a situation where I referred out a speaker last week. That's not easy to do. You basically feel like you're sending money away. But the reality is if we're not a good fit, I want to refer them. In the situation that you have, people are asking for access to this great book of opportunity for them to fix their home or whatever. And you know, the fear is that a large home builder will lock up your person for a long time. You know, so I've seen that before, but there's always backfill for that. There's always people that come back and you get this situation where their quality. And again, if we treat our people right, we treat our referrals right, then it's a consistent circular nature behind it. Cool. All right. So just a quick slide here. I got maybe 10 books left. So they're $15 if you want them cash or credit card. My autograph is free. And so we can see that. As we wrap up this entire conference, I want to share with you an experience I had with my friend David. David was a longtime client of mine, and he was a lawyer, and he bought a couple websites. He was a title attorney, right? Did closings, and I had a foursome in the Chamber Golf Tournament, and the night before the tournament, somebody backed out, and I called David, and I said, hey, you want to golf tomorrow? And he said, yeah, sure. So he came out, we got on the first tee, and he lined up right above that ball. And then he did that thing that golfers do. Why do we do that? I don't have no idea. I don't think it makes the ball go any farther or straighter. So he swings, and he misses completely. And I'm behind him going, oh, it's going to be a long day. I thought I brought in a ringer, because I wanted to win the chamber tournament. So don't worry, David, it's gonna be a good day out here. The weather's great. Just go ahead and hit again. We got all day. So he lines up, and this time he connects. Thunk! And it's going, and going, and going, all the way over into the woods. It was a really long day of golf. On the third hole, David looked at me and he said, by the way, I hate golf. I said, why the hell did you agree to come out and go golfing with me? He said, because you asked. I said, oh, that's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. By the 10th hole, we had figured out that David had an easier time finding the beer in the beer cart than his ball in the woods. And he had quit for the day. He rode the last 9 holes out on the cart with his feet up on the dashboard and a beer in his hand. And as we're approaching the 18th green, he turns to me and he says, "Now this was some championship golf." And I look at him and say, "David, that was championship beer drinking." He says, "Oh, by the way, give me a call tomorrow. I want to talk some business." It's the first time in 5 hours the word business had been mentioned. We didn't even check in. "Hey, how's your business doing? How's your business doing?" We didn't even check in. It was the first time all day the word business was mentioned. Called him the next day, and David bought a $10,000 website for me. 2 weeks later, referred another lawyer who bought another $10,000 website. I can't guarantee that if you go golfing with somebody, you'll get $20,000 in business. But I can tell you that bad golf and good relationships produces referrals. That relationship had existed for over 10 years. He'd bought over five websites plus a whole bunch of other services from us. Probably amounted to hundreds of thousands of dollars over the years. But it was a relationship that mattered. We knew each other. We built a deep, meaningful, mutual relationship. I referred a lot of people to him, and he referred a lot of people to me. That's because I believe in doing business with people that we don't just know, like, and trust. I believe we do business with people that we know, like, trust, and care about. I refer to it as the high five effect. That when you're walking down an office hallway or at a conference hallway with anybody you enjoy hanging out with, that you simply give them a high five. That the type of people that you'd like to be with, the type of clients that you want to bring on to your property management company, your software development company, whatever it may be, that the type of people that we want in this membership organization, the type of people that we can high five. Do you agree? Absolutely. I would encourage you that as you leave here today, and you hang out the rest of the day, that you simply see anybody walking around the grounds, whether they work here or not, you simply high-five them. They won't have any idea what you're talking about. In the meantime, if you feel inclined to high-five somebody around you, feel free to do so. Thank you for your time. There you go. Dan, I think you're up. Me? Oh, okay.